It's been an amazing journey, this life of mine. This planet has filled me with the wonder of all living things, great and small. We cannot ignore this earth that surrounds us, that feeds us, shelters us, replenishes our bodies and our souls, and stretches our imaginations, where animals, plants, air, water, all care for us. We're all interconnected, people, animals, our environment. When nature suffers, we suffer. And when nature flourishes, we all flourish. I do believe in the possibility of a world where we can live in harmony with nature, but only if every one of us does our part to make that world a reality. So that when you look back over your journey, your life, you can truly say, I did make a difference. Patrick, thank you. What a wonderful opening to this evening to have this amazing check from your safari park. Thank you. Thank you to the volunteers and the board and the staff of the Jane Goodall Institute. And thank you to all of you for being here tonight. I'm going to start with my usual opening, and I think there are people here who should be able to reply. Sometimes there are. I can't speak Dutch, even though my great-great-grandfather was Dutch, even though I married a Dutchman. I can't speak your extraordinary language, which I'm told is a disease of the throat. That's what I was told. At any rate, I can greet you in chimpanzee. And Patrick ought to be able to answer me, but he always says he won't, and I don't really know why. But maybe there's some keepers here this evening. And if we can't dim this light, I'm going to move away from it. That's better. Right. So I... Who's going to answer? Because that is the greeting of the chimpanzee. And if you came with me to Gombe National Park, you might climb up and hear that call. And basically, each chimpanzee has his or her own distinctive pantoot, and that is how the members of the scattered community interact with each other. I suppose I'm supposed to be here for your live streaming, aren't I? Okay, I've suddenly realized all the people out there can't see me. I'll endure this. It'll give me a headache and make my eyes cry, but that's modern technology for you. Let me go back to the beginning because I think it's very important. I think that on my life's journey, there have been various people that have helped me become who I am. And the first one I have to mention was my amazing mother, who supported my love of animals, which I seem to have been born with, who didn't freak out when she found, aged 1.5, I'd taken a whole handful of earthworms to bed with me. She just said, Jane, if you leave them here, they'll die because they need the earth, and we took them back to the garden. And when I was 4.5, living in London, and we had a holiday in the country, and I was asked to help collect the hen's eggs. We were on a farm, a proper farm, not an intensive farm. And so I apparently began asking everybody, but where does the egg come out of the hen? Because here's the egg. And I couldn't see a hole that big on the hen. Well, nobody answered me to my satisfaction. So one day I saw this hen. I can remember her still. She was brown, and she went into this little hen house. There were about 8 little hen houses with the nest boxes around the edge. They slept there at night. And I'm thinking, I suppose, she's going to lay an egg, and I crawled after her. Big mistake, she flew out with squawks of, I suppose, fear, thinking, well, no hen will lay an egg here now. It's a frightening place. But I suppose that I was now on a mission. I thought I was going to watch a hen lay an egg. I made a mistake. She flew out. So I went into an empty hen house and waited. I waited and waited, which was fine for me, but my poor family had no idea where I was. And apparently they called the police. It was getting dark. And yet when my mother saw this little girl, her precious little firstborn child, rushing towards the house, she saw my shining eyes, and instead of getting mad at me, "How dare you go off without telling us? Don't you dare do it again," she sat down to hear the amazing story of how a hen lays an egg. I can close my eyes and see it as though it was yesterday. The hen very obligingly turned so that her back was to me, and she raised up a little bit, and the slightly soft oblong egg came out and plopped onto the straw. And I don't know who was the more excited, of the chicken or me. At any rate, because my mother noticed that this, well, it wasn't at the making of a little scientist, curiosity, asking questions, not getting the right answer, deciding to find out for yourself, making a mistake, not giving up, and learning patience. It was all there in that little five-year-old child. And a different kind of mother might have crushed that curiosity, and I might not have gone on to do what I've done. And she nurtured my love of animals. She found books for me to read about animals. We had very little money. It was wartime. My father was off fighting, and clothes were secondhand. We didn't take anything for granted. One square of chocolate was a treat, not a privilege, not a something you accepted. And books came from libraries, but there were secondhand bookshops, wonderful secondhand bookshops. And my little pennies of pocket money, I saved up and saved up. And I used to spend hours in these shops. And one day I found this little book. Some of you know this. It was called Tarzan of the Apes. And I just had enough money to buy it. And I took it up into my favorite tree in the garden. And of course, I fell passionately in love with this glorious Lord of the Jungle. What 10-year-old little girl who loved animals wouldn't fall passionately in love with Tarzan? And what did Tarzan go and do? He married the wrong Jane. Well, so at any rate, of course I knew there wasn't a Tarzan. Luckily, I wasn't born with no brains. But that was what started my passion. I will grow up, go to Africa, live with wild animals, and write books about them. And everybody laughed at me. How would I do that? Africa was a faraway country. We didn't know much about it. It was the dark continent. World War II was raging. As I've said, we didn't have any money, and I was just a mere girl. Girls didn't have those opportunities. We're going back now a long time, when I was 10. And only my mother said, if you really want to do this thing, you're going to have to work awfully hard. You're going to have to take advantage of opportunity, but don't give up. And that's the message I've taken to children all around the world, disadvantaged children, children in rural Africa, children in parts of Asia, children in inner cities, children with parents who are conservative and don't believe that girls should do that sort of thing. And the number of young people and older people now who've come and thanked me and said, you taught me, you did it, so I can do it too. That is so magical. That's thanks to my mother. So that's why I like to mention her. And when I left school, there was no money for university, but there was just enough money for secretarial college. And I got my secretarial diploma, or whatever you got. And then I got this wonderful job in London, which was actually not even secretarial, which I always hated. I was quite good at it, but I hated it. But this was with documentary films. And so I learned about documentary filmmaking. And that has been so useful to me in my life. And then came this letter from a school friend inviting me to Kenya for a holiday. That was the opportunity. Still no money, worked as a waitress for about, 5 months. Jolly hard work, by the way. until finally I had enough money for a return fare to Africa by boat, which was how we traveled back then. And so age 23, which is quite old now, but was very young back then. One was very naive at 23, having lived through World War II, and arrived in Kenya, was met by my friend, driving to her farm, a giraffe, a real wild giraffe, looking down at me from that long neck with those beautiful eyelashes. And I knew I'd arrived in Africa. The dream had become reality. Meeting Louis Leakey, going to talk to him about animals, being offered a job. You see, the secretarial training was useful. He needed a secretary. And that led to him taking me on a safari to Olduvai Gorge. And there, one evening, Gillian and I, the one other young English girl, we were allowed out on the plains every evening, and there was this young male lion, fully grown, never seen anything like me and Gillian before, and he followed us two or three times the length of this room, which was a bit scary, but it was very exciting, and I think that was the day Louis decided I was the person he'd been looking for. For years, he said, to go and study not just any animal, but chimpanzees, the ones most like us. That was something beyond my wildest dreams. It was not easy to get the money. Who was going to give money for this young, untrained girl? It wasn't easy to get permission from what was then Tanganyika, part of the crumbling British Empire. And the authorities were not prepared to take responsibility for this young girl. What a crazy, stupid idea. But in the end, they said, all right, but she must have a companion. It was that same amazing mother who agreed to come with me. And it was a very, very primitive camp that we set up with an old ex-army tent and one Tanzanian cook who often got drunk on the locally made banana wine. And so I would go happily up into the hills and leave my mother down there with the scorpions and centipedes and baboons wandering in and an often drunk cook. So wasn't she amazing? Yes, she was amazing. We had money for 6 months and she came for four of those months. But I should say that while I was waiting for Louis Leakey to get that 6 months' money, I was back in England learning all that I could about chimpanzees. Nobody knew anything about them in the wild, but there were some studies on chimpanzees in captivity, and reading everything I could, I went to the London Zoo. I got a job there, and it was with the Granada television unit, and there were two chimpanzees in the zoo at that time, one male, one female. They had a typical old-fashioned zoo cage stretching, I suppose, from about here to the wall. In the daytime, they were locked out, except in the winter, when they were locked in all the time. And at nighttime, every night, they were locked in. There was one bench out in this concrete space, and the other one was broken. So, of course, the male got the bench. The female had to sit on the hot cement floor. There was no running water. It was just up to a keeper. And these were the old-fashioned keepers. It was a job to them. It was a job to get through. They didn't really care or understand the animals they were supposed to be caring for. And I used to go and visit these two sad chimpanzees. And I vowed at that time I would do something to help them. So that was my first real experience with zoos, a very, very bad zoo in London, the zoo in London. Going back to Gombe, realizing that this was not as easy as I had hoped it might be, because chimpanzees, being very conservative, would take one look at this weird white ape and vanish into the undergrowth. And I knew that if I didn't see something exciting before the first 6 months' money ran out, that would be the end of the study. And my mother was such a support at that time because I'd found this peak And from that peak with my binoculars, I could observe the chimps first in this valley and then in that valley. And she would say to me when I came down depressed, but Jane, you're learning something more than you think. You've seen chimpanzees going, traveling by themselves in little groups, what seem like family groups. You've seen two groups meet up. You've seen them embracing and kissing. You're learning the kind of foods they eat. You're seeing how they bend over the branches and make nice, comfortable, springy platforms to sleep on at night. You're learning the different calls that they make. You're learning more than you think. And it was really sad that the breakthrough observation was just 2 weeks after she had to leave and go back to England. And that was the never-to-be-forgotten day when I saw the first chimp who'd begun to lose his fear of me, reaching out, breaking off grass stems, using them as tools to fish termites from their nest, breaking off a leafy twig, stripping the leaves, showing the beginning of tool making, which wouldn't be exciting now. We know how many animals, how different number of different species can use tools. But back then it was exciting because it was thought that humans and only humans used and made tools. Man the toolmaker, we were defined. And that was the breakthrough in that Lewis was able to involve the National Geographic Society, who said they would provide money for me to continue with the study when the 6 months' money was over. And they sent out Hugo van Lawick, my second Dutch connection. First was my great-great-grandfather, who, of course, I never knew. And then came Hugo van Lawick, whose family lived in Amsterdam. I visited many times. And he came with his amazing skill as a photographer and a filmmaker. And it was those early photographs in the National Geographic magazines and those early geographic documentaries that took the chimpanzees, what I was learning about them, into, first of all, the homes across America and then gradually around the rest of the world. So that was how it all began. And gradually, as the weeks went by, more and more chimpanzees lost their fear. And I began to know them as individuals, each with his or her distinct personality. And for any of you who read those early articles, there was David Greybeard and his close companion, Goliath, the top-ranking male at the time, with his very fast and dramatic charging display, which you can see when you see chimpanzees here. You can see the males displaying, charging across the ground, stamping with their feet, slapping with their hands, throwing objects, swaying vegetation. And Mike, a low-ranking male, but a male who was highly motivated to improve his rank. There were 11 adult males at that time, which is more than usual at Gombe. And Mike ranked bottom, lowest of all of them. And I'd see him sitting, watching these other males who were all at that time his superiors. Mike learned to capitalize from the fact that lying around my camp, and by this time the chimpanzees were coming to get bananas because they took bananas and I asked my cook to leave bananas out for them. So they began to come. And on this one occasion, Mike grabbed an empty kerosene can, a 4-gallon tin can, because that's how I lit my lamp at night. And he incorporated into his charging display, and it made a big racket going as he hit and kicked it across the ground. And I think all the males at one time or another grabbed one of these cans, but only Mike capitalized on that chance experience. And he learned to keep three of them ahead of him. And the most dramatic occasion that I remember so vividly, he was sitting on his own, and there were six males, all his superiors, grooming each other. And Mike's looking at them, and his hair begins to rise a little, and he starts rocking from side to side. And he goes over to the tent where the cans were piled up, ready to be taken back. And he took two of them. He took them exactly back to where he'd been sitting. And he put them down and he rocked a little more and his hair came out a little more. And then he deliberately went and took another can. So now he had three in front of him, and that's when he set off, hitting and kicking them. And along with his charging display was the ooh, 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 his distinctive pant hoot. And of course, the other males rushed out of his way because it was quite a racket coming towards them. And he sat there, panting, out of breath, and the other males came back. And now he was the center of the grooming group. And it took 4 months for him to become alpha male. As far as we know, no serious attack, no chimpanzees with tufts of hair torn out, no wounds, and he reigned for the next 6 years. I was beginning to learn about the importance of the type of mothering, so that there were females, I gradually realized, who were much better mothers than others. Some were more affectionate, more playful, more protective, but not overprotective, above all, supportive, so that even if their child got into trouble with a higher ranking individual, the mother would nevertheless go in to support the child, even though she might be attacked. And over the years, we've realized that the youngsters of the supportive, the good mothers, tend to do better. The males tend to rise eventually to a higher rank. The females are better mothers, more successful mothers. And so just as in human society, in chimp society, there are good and bad mothers. Gestures, postures, communication, kissing, holding hands, patting one another, begging, sharing, begging for a share of food, swaggering, shaking the fist, throwing objects, using tools, making tools. And it seems to me that the long childhood, because a chimpanzee infant will remain suckling, traveling with the mother, riding on her back, sleeping with her at night for the first 5 years. That's a very long period of childhood dependency. And it seems to me that just as our children need a long childhood because they have so much to learn, so it is with chimpanzees. They're not born with a whole raft of instinctive behavior that dictates to them how they shall behave. They watch, they learn, they imitate. And we now know that in different parts of Africa, there are different tool-using behaviors, and everywhere it's recorded how the young ones will watch, and then they'll try to imitate, and at first they don't do very well, but eventually, by the time they're 3 or 4, at Gombe they're pretty good at using tools to fish for termites, and these long sticks that have to be very straight, which are peeled of all bark, so that they're smooth, and they push this down into the nest of these vicious biting army ants or driver ants, leave it for a moment, the ants swarm out, and then a great mass of swarming ants, they have to eat very quickly and they don't last very long before they have to run away because they're covered with biting ants. One young male, he thought he was so smart, he found the perfect way to fish for these vicious ants. He got himself onto a vine between two trees above the nest. And with his stick, he was pushing it down. He was completely safe until the vine broke and he landed right in the middle of the nest. Well, he didn't try that again. At any rate, as the months turned into years, gradually realizing that chimpanzees like us have a dark side, the males have a territory. They regularly patrol the territory. If they see an individual, or maybe two, from a neighboring social group, they will try to catch that individual. They basically stalk them. And if they catch them, subject them to fierce and savage attacks. They show behavior which is normally seen when they're killing a prey animal, like twisting a limb round and round, tearing off strips of skin, even drinking blood. That's not seen in a normal chimpanzee fight. So that there are in-groups and out-groups in their society. And these individuals from neighboring communities, those others will die of wounds inflicted. But they also have a different side to their nature, just like us, and they're capable of love and compassion and true altruism, where even a non-related individual will adopt a motherless orphan and save the life. I don't know if any of you have seen a film made by Disney called Chimpanzee, but that was a true life story where the alpha male adopted a motherless infant. It didn't have a happy ending, but to see that alpha male for a while abandon all his alpha duties to look after this infant. And there are two other chimpanzee study sites which have recorded alpha males looking after orphans. So it was long before I knew what we know now about chimpanzees. I'd been in Gombe 2 years. I got a letter from Louis Leakey telling me I had to go to Cambridge University to get a degree because he wouldn't always be around to get money for me. And I needed that piece of paper. I needed that education. He said there was no time for me to mess about getting a BA. I had to go straight for a PhD. And he got me a place in Cambridge University to study ethology, to get a PhD in ethology. I didn't even know what ethology was. I was very nervous when I got there. Can you imagine what it felt like to be told by these erudite professors, of whom I was really nervous, that I had done everything wrong? Chimpanzees given names in a scientific study, that's not science. They should have numbers. Talking about chimpanzees with personalities, with minds capable of thinking, with emotions, happiness, sadness, fear, despair, that was guilty of anthropomorphism, the worst crime a scientist can commit, attributing human qualities to non-human beings. And, you know, timid, nervous as I was, I thought back to my childhood teacher. And thinking of what I'd learned as a child from that teacher, I could stand up to those professors because I knew they were wrong. That teacher was my dog. You can't, all of you, you all animal lovers here, you can't share your life in a meaningful way with a dog or a cat or a bird or in a zoo, the relationships you make with the various animals, and not know that, of course, animals have personalities, minds, and feelings. But back then it was thought that there was this sharp line and humans were on one side of it and all the other animals were on the other side. And it was thought to be a difference in kind. This is true. This is how it was when I got to Cambridge. And so I think it was really fortunate that it was chimpanzees, who we now know are biologically so like us, that we share 98% of their DNA, that the blood and the immune system are so like ours, that the anatomy of the brain. Because they're so like us biologically, it was easier to start breaking down this barrier, this non-existent line dividing us from them. And chimpanzees helped science to begin to admit that it wasn't only biological similarities, it was also psychological and behavioral similarities, and that we humans are part of and not separated from the amazing animal kingdom. Well, I got my degree, I went back to the field, I built up a research station, and it was an idyllic life. And now, well, now I'm traveling 300 days a year, all around the world. I have no time for research anymore. I get back to Gombe twice a year, but just for a few days, just a couple of days, one of which I always spend alone in the forest, out there where you realize the interconnectedness of all living things, out there where you're in one of the lungs of the world. But things changed for me when I went to a conference in 1986. And the various people studying chimpanzees in different parts of Africa came together for the first time and we had a session on conservation and learned chimpanzee numbers were disappearing, forests were being cut down, the bushmeat trade, hunting, the commercial hunting of wild animals for food, chimpanzees caught in wire snares set for antelopes, able to break the wire but not able to remove the tightened noose, losing a hand or a foot, or even dying of gangrene, mothers shot so that infants could be sold for zoos in those days, zoos in Europe, zoos in America, entertainment, circuses, pets, and for medical research. We had a session on conditions in the medical research labs, the cruel training of chimpanzees performing in circuses or other forms of entertainment. But I couldn't sleep for nights after seeing our closest living relatives imprisoned in 5-foot by 5-foot cages, bars all around, bars above, bars below, maybe a motor tire to sit on. And so I left that conference without making any conscious decision to change from this idyllic life in the forest to an activist. Since then, I haven't been more than 3 weeks consecutively in any one place. And there's only about 2 times a year when I get 3 weeks off from this constant travel. I don't know what I thought I could do. As I say, I didn't make a conscious decision to leave Gombe. It just happened. And learning more about the chimps' plight, I felt was necessary before I could even think of what I might do about it. Traveling around Africa, getting a little grant, doing wildlife awareness weeks, learning a lot about the plight of chimps, the plight of orphans who've been confiscated because it was illegal to shoot a mother, but nobody was enforcing those laws. Nevertheless, those infants could be confiscated. They were put in sanctuaries which were like really bad zoos. I met some of these pathetic infants in terrible zoos in different parts of Africa. And I was also learning about the plight of so many people living in and around chimpanzee habitat, the poverty, the hunger, the lack of education and health facilities. And flying over Gombe and looking down and seeing what had been part of a belt of forest, now a little isolated island, surrounded by completely bare hills, an island of forest, surrounded by bare hills, people desperate to survive, cutting the last of the trees because they had to try and grow crops or make charcoal to get some money, cutting the trees even on the really steep slopes, trying to grow food there, exhausting the farmland, terrible erosion, soil washing down into the streams. And that's when I realized, unless we could improve the lives of the people, there was no way we could even try to save the chimpanzees. And that led to the Jane Goodall Institute's programs now in 7 African countries, improving the lives of the people, not marching in as a bunch of arrogant white people. Well, you've made a right mess of your life. This is what we're going to do. This is going to make your life better. And you better be grateful. It wasn't like that. It was getting a group of local people. They didn't even have a PhD among them. They were not threatening to the villagers. They'd all worked in NGOs, in forestry and education and so forth. And they went and sat with the villagers and asked them what they thought we could do to make their lives better. And that's how we started and gradually built up trust and gradually introduced programs to restore fertility to the soil, no chemicals, of course, and programs working with the local Tanzanian education and health authorities to improve the education of children and the health facilities, introducing the family planning information, which is so important, introducing programs to improve the education of children, but particularly programs that would keep girls in school after puberty, which means you have to build hygienic latrines, and introducing what I believe is the best of all microcredit programs, where women can ask for a tiny loan to start what must be an environmentally stable project, like buying a few chickens, selling the eggs, or getting a little piece of land to grow pineapples or corn or something, selling the produce, paying the money back so that they can be proud. We did it. This is our project. We paid the money back. We own it. Then they can take out a larger loan if they wish. And so gradually the people came to trust and believe in us. And what began in 12 villages around Gombe spread into 55 villages around Gombe, the greater Gombe ecosystem, further south where the last of Tanzania's wild chimpanzees live, not protected at all, just in village forest land. And using the same sort of technique for the villages there, so that around Gombe, the trees were being restored as land was set aside for conservation by people who were now able to think about conservation, who were able to think as they knew all the time, but if we cut down all the trees, we destroy our future. And because the land is so resilient and the seeds are so filled with magic, the trees began to grow back. We started off planting them, and we realized we didn't have to. The land left alone was restoring itself, at least in this part of Africa. So all around Gombe and the bare hills are now no longer bare. The forest is back. And down in the south, the forest still stands because we're using the same program to improve the lives of the people there, so they don't need to cut the trees down. And as I say, that program is now in 6 different African countries, modified to suit the country and the communities where it's introduced. Well, hard work. Hard work getting the money for these projects, but success, it's not much use any of us fighting to save the environment, fighting to save species, unless the new generations are going to be better stewards than we've been. I don't think I need to talk to anybody here about what we're doing to the planet, but we can think about the similarities between us and chimpanzees. But there's also a major difference. Chimpanzees are highly intelligent. And you saw that from Patrick's film, which was great, Patrick. I hadn't seen it before. I only read about it. And chimpanzees, like the chimpanzee eye in Japan, some of you must have seen eye's performance on a computer. And Ai's son, Ayumu, who is so good at remembering the position of numbers on a computer screen, the people have now gone from all over the world to try and beat him, and they can't. I mean, I've sat there with him, and here's this screen with numbers, and here's a blank screen with just empty squares. And all he has to do is remember the order, which is random, of numbers from 0 to 9, and then replicate it in the blank squares in the same order. So by the time I found 0, 1, and 2, he's finished the whole thing. And the point is, when you press one square over here, everything there disappears. So there's this photographic memory, which we don't understand. There's so much left to learn. So these chimpanzees, you know, they can learn signs of American sign languages used by deaf people. They can learn more than 500 of them. If you know that language, you can have a conversation with them. But even so, you can't really compare even the brightest chimpanzee with a human who's designed a rocket that can go up to Mars, from which a little robot crawls and can creep around taking photographs. So isn't it bizarre that if we accept that we are the most intellectual creature that's ever walked the planet, that the biggest difference between us, chimps and other animals, is this explosive development of our intellect, which I actually believe is something to do with the fact that somewhere along our evolution, we developed the way of communicating, as I'm communicating with you now, with words, So I can tell you about things you may never have seen or heard about, so that we can teach our children about things that are not present, so that we can talk about the past. We can make plans for the distant future. Chimpanzees can plan for the immediate future, but they couldn't plan 10 years ahead, as far as we know. But most important of all, we can discuss. We can bring people from different disciplines, from different knowledge sets together to try to solve problems. How bizarre then that this amazingly intellectual species is destroying its only home. And with the pollution, with climate change, with the overuse of fossil fuels, with the production of CO2, carbon dioxide, and methane gas, making these so-called greenhouse gases that are circling the planet and trapping the heat of the sun, so that the polar ice is melting, so that sea temperatures are rising. I've met people who've had to leave their homes, island homes, because at high tide, it's not possible to live there anymore. There was a big article the other day about what's happening in Florida. And in Florida, these homes that have been built with hundreds of thousands of dollars, and now at high tide, the salt water is seeping up through these carefully manicured lawns and killing them. That's climate change. And yet the United States has elected a president who denies climate change, who says that it was invented by the Chinese to give them some kind of trade advantage. But we know it's true, and we know we're polluting the air, the water, and the land, and we know that we're destroying biodiversity, and we know that we're using up the natural resources of the planet faster than the planet can renew them. And we know that we've got to get together and find solutions, and that maybe not such a big window of time to do it. And so that's why I'm working so hard with young people, with our Roots and Shoots program, which began in Tanzania like so much did. Young people, 12 of them, came to talk to me about what they saw as problems. Children in the street sniffing glue, homeless children, homeless people, cruelty to dogs, stray dogs, the destruction of the coral reef, the litter that was everywhere, the cruel treatment of animals in the markets out in the hot sun with no water. They had so many problems. And so we got together a big group, or they got together a big group from 9 different high schools. And they all sat down and talked about this. And from that, this Roots and Shoots program was developed. And it's a program which is not like other youth programs, although it has elements of many of them. It's a program where young people sit, talk about the problems they care about, work out what they can do about them, roll up their sleeves, go out there and take action. And right from the start, it was felt this needed to be holistic, and that each group would choose between them 3 projects. One to help people, one to help other animals, and one to help the environment we all share. And so what began with these 12 high school students in Dar es Salaam in Tanzania is now in almost 100 countries. We have members from kindergarten through university, even some adult groups as well. And these young people are changing the world. Why is it called Roots and Shoots? I love trees, and you've got some beautiful trees around here. Think of your favorite tree. I'm thinking of the beech tree I climbed as a child, up which I read Tarzan. My tree began as a little seed, and if I'd picked it up back then, little white roots and a little shoot as it began to grow, how small, how insignificant, how weak, and yet the life force, the magic, I call it magic, in that seed is so powerful that those little roots to reach the water can work through rocks and eventually push them aside. And that little shoot to reach the sunlight can work through cracks in a brick wall and eventually knock it down. So see the rocks and the walls as all the problems we humans inflict on the planet. And then this is a reason for hope. Hundreds and thousands of young people and not so young people around the world working together can make this a better world for all living things. So we've got a little tiny short piece of video taken some time ago, but it will just give you an idea of some of what I mean when I talk about the energy of young people and the success of this Roots and Shoots program. Yeah, this is the map. The dark green is where we have most Roots and Shoots. The darker is less, the pale. Soweto, South Africa, for those of you who can't see at the back, the gumboot dance. These are in America.
Hello.
This is in Nepal with very poor children. This is North Korea, where we did have 3 groups. I doubt they're there now. Argentina, spread right across the country now. And Austria, very successful in Austria. That's America. This is China, mainland China. And I should tell you, I just got back from China. And it's the first time, and I've been going back to China for over 20 years now, it's the first time I've really understood the impact that this program has had in China. The number of people who came up to me wherever I was saying, I was in your Roots and Shoots program when I was at school, or I watched early geographic documentaries when I was a child. That's what made me start thinking about the environment. That's what made me start understanding that animals had feelings like we did. And I just want to tell you, the change in attitude in China is so huge over the years I've been going there. They're now leading in solar clean energy, for example, and wind energy. There's a huge change afoot in China. It's traveling around, meeting so many young people with shining eyes, wanting to tell Dr. Jane what they've been doing to make this world a better place. We have very strong programs in zoos around the world. We even have a program called Chimpanzoo, which it was and is here in the Netherlands. I had to think for a minute which country I was in, but I think I'm right, Netherlands, yes. So Chimpanzoo is all about improving the lives of chimpanzees in zoos, enriching their lives, and young people are so passionate about that. And of course, we also have these programs, these sanctuaries in Africa, where we care for orphan chimpanzees, and you'll see one of those presently. But young people are raising money here in the Netherlands to become chimpanzee guardians, so that at least one little chimpanzee, they can feel we're making a contribution to keep that little chimpanzee alive, and they get information from our biggest sanctuary, which is in Congo, Brazzaville. And so the Roots and Shoots youth is what gives me the most hope. It's not that children can change the world. They are changing the world, even as we speak. They're so filled with imagination. They're so filled with enthusiasm. And when you hear we haven't inherited this world from our parents, we borrowed it from our children, I get so angry because we haven't borrowed anything from them. We've stolen from them. And it's about time we get together with them and help them in these huge efforts that they're doing to make things better for the future. So Roots and Shoots is my greatest reason for hope. My next reason is this human brain. And I know that here in the Netherlands, there are some very innovative programs to provide energy from the sun, the Waka Waka, what's the name of the company?
Waka Waka.
Waka Waka, but then... Green Choice. And we're having a relationship with these wonderful people and these wonderful companies. And the innovation here in the Netherlands is going to change the lives of many of our young people in Africa. Many of our Roots and Shoots kids can use the light from the sun at night when it's dark to do their homework and read books. They couldn't do that before. So the human brain, when it sets its mind to solving the problems, that is so exciting because amazing things are happening. And if we could just persuade governments to subsidize these things instead of always subsidizing fossil fuel and so forth, the world would be a much better place already. But the good news, many big corporations have seen the future. The writing on the wall, they are changing. They are trying to produce their goods in a more environmentally sustainable way. They're understanding that if they don't, there will be nothing left for them to produce from. It'll be gone. And governments will follow the path that the general public and the big companies pave. The governments will have to follow and make the right kind of legislation. Next reason for hope, the resilience of nature. I've already talked about it. Forests coming back around Gombe from the power of the seeds in the soil, if it's given a chance. Animals rescued from the very brink of extinction and given another chance. Next reason for hope, social media. You can now get millions, eventually billions of people around the world together around a single issue. And I've had first-hand experience of that. And I think probably many people in this room can see the power of social media. And of course, that links up also to the intellect that designed it. And then finally, there's the indomitable human spirit. That's why I carry around Mr. H., who was given to me by a man who went blind when he was 21 in the US Marines. His name is Gary Horn, which is why this is Mr. H. And Gary, for some reason, having gone blind, decided to become a magician. And everybody told him, Gary, you can't be a good magician if you're blind. He said, I can try. Children don't know he's blind. And then he'll tell them and say, things may go wrong in your life because we never know. But if they do, don't give up. There's always a way forward. And he does cross-country skiing and he does deep-sea diving, scuba diving, and he does skydiving, jumping out of aeroplanes. And he's just taken up a new hobby, this totally blind man, can't even see light and dark. He's just produced a book called Blind Artist. He's learned to paint. His wife puts the color that he asks for on the brush. He has a braille ruler. He works out the place. He painted the most amazing portrait of Mr. H just by feeling him. And he thought he was giving me a stuffed chimp for my birthday 24 years ago. And I said, Gary, you have got no excuse. I made him hold the tail. Chimps don't have tails. He said, never mind, take him where you go, and you know my spirit's with you. So he's been with me now to 63 countries and probably touched by about 4 million people, because if you touch him, the magic, the inspiration rubs off. And all around us, there are people who do things that might seem impossible, people with tremendous physical disabilities who lead lives that are absolutely inspirational. the icons like Nelson Mandela, but just people who overcome the difficulties, the refugees who come not knowing English, not having any money, and somehow make a living for themselves. And if you go and talk to them, they'll smile at you. This indomitable human spirit. And you know something? Every single one of us in this room has that same indomitable human spirit. That's one of the blessings we get from being human. We have this incredible spirit within us. If we will just give it a chance, if we will remember that we as individuals make a difference every day, that we make little choices which may seem small about what we buy, what we wear, what we do, how we interact with the environment, animals and people. And it may seem, just me, I can't do much, just me wouldn't, but there can be millions and millions of people now around the world all making better ethical choices, trying to leave more environmentally friendly footprints as they go along their journey through life. We can all make a difference. And every single day, every single one of us makes an impact. We have a choice. What kind of impact will we make today? That's the message I have for you. And thank you for being here. And all you people out there with this amazing social media kind of stuff, I wish you were with us. But we greet you. And thank you for being with us out there in the cyberspace.